Welcome to a very special interview. I want to introduce you to someone who's just a new friend to me. And of course, he's a friend because he plays football and he used to be a professional footballer. So what I want to do is introduce you to Lee Payne. Lee, tell us a little bit about yourself, but tell us a little bit about the history as a professional footballer.
Well, I'm a Luton lad, Howard. I was born in Luton.
No.
Yeah, Luton. Something good got to come out of Luton, yeah. You know. And that was where I learned my football trade at Luton. They were in the first division then, back in the day. David Pleat was a manager who went on to manage Tottenham. So it was a good apprenticeship. It was a good learning process for me there. And
so how long ago was that, last week?
That was, for I wish, 1984,
yeah,
1983.
Yeah.
Yeah, 1983. And it was a dream since I was a little boy. You know, I wanted to be a professional footballer.
Who doesn't?
Exactly, we all do. And that's why I was extremely blessed to, you know, for it to happen to me. You know, I didn't think I was anything special. It was just, I just felt really comfortable playing football. And like I say, I did an apprenticeship at Luton and had to go through a bit of rejection. They didn't offer me a professional contract. So I had a couple of years in non-league, which was probably the most enjoyable time of my football career.
Why was that?
Just because
more game time?
And more game time and the pressure's off a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's professional football. You know, it's very intense, and the competition for 11 places is every week.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you got to remember, there's sometimes 25 pros fighting for 11 places.
Yeah.
You know, so going non-league, you know, you found the banter was different and a bit more relaxed. And I was only 17. I was playing with men. You know, and it toughened me up. I never give my dream up, Howard. You know, and I went from non-league to back to the Premier League, which was then called the Barclays League Division One, because it hadn't mm-hmm. gotten to the Premier at that stage. It was 1988. But to join a big club like Newcastle United in that period was a dream come true for me. Mm-hmm. You know.
Now you made a good friend with somebody in particular, because you've got a connection to Brazil, haven't you?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, it just so happened that when I signed for Newcastle, the big star at that time was a player called Mirandinha, who he'd actually scored against England at Wembley for Brazil. Newcastle and United audaciously made this little sneaky bid for a Brazilian. They were the first club in England to sign a Brazilian, and they managed to get him from Palmeiras. And he came, you imagine him arriving in Tyneside, it was amazing.
Boy unconfined, as Gascoigne's cheeky chip found Mirandinha free, and the boy from Brazil opened his St James's Park account. It was a magic moment he just had to share with a man who suffered so much this past week.
Mirandinha bangs it in.
Might not come to that if Mirandinha can keep his goal-scoring touch.
Imperiously. Grobbelaar has lost it. Mirandinha's in here. A disaster for Bruce Grobbelaar. A triumph for Mirandinha.
He was incredible talent, incredible training with him every day. And I'd sit with him on the bus and pick his brains, you know, because he'd played with some of the greats, you know, and he was an inspirational player. And we always kept in touch. And I ended up later on in life going out to Brazil, which was life-changing, which I'm sure we'll talk about in many ways.
Well, do tell us now, because the thing is, I'm going to give the game away a little bit here,
yeah.
Because you're now a born-again Christian.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
And we'll come to know more about that in terms of how it affected you in the especially behind the scenes, say, in the dressing room at Newcastle to, say, the dressing room in Brazil, where there's so many Christians, right?
That's right, yeah. Well, the funny thing was, I never went to church as a young boy. I didn't come from a Christian background at all. We were very working class. My dad and all my family were all involved in football, and it was quite a tough upbringing. I often joke that the closest I got to a Bible was chasing off the Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, when they come on our council estate. You know, that was probably as close as I got then, and just to show you how raw it was. But I always felt God's presence, Howard, you know.
Since when?
since I was probably 6-7 years old.
That's interesting.
I used to write poems about God, and my mum and dad would say to me, wow, isn't that lovely, you know? We don't really know where that's coming from. But they didn't discourage me. They thought it was sweet.
Yeah.
You know, they thought it was sweet. But I always felt his presence. And when I signed for Newcastle United, I remember doing a couple of live radio interviews on the local radios up there, and I mentioned God. And they looked at me like I was...
An alien.
Yeah. You know? And I got the nickname of, you know, some of the boys picked up on it, and they used to call me Holy Joe.
Yeah.
But I hadn't read the Bible at this stage, Howard. I was talking about God, but never... I didn't know the gospel.
My goodness.
Had no idea.
What sort of things were you saying then?
I just felt God's presence. I just said, I think God is... I was talking to God all my life. I was always in relationship with him, talking with him.
But I mean, you know, to be in a football club, I mean, is probably one of the can I say, the worst places to even talk about God, because they'll think you're a Holy Joe, and there's a lot of banter and things that go on there, that are swearing and stuff like that.
I think it helped the fact that I wasn't going to church, because for me it was just a personal relationship. I didn't think anything of it. It was so natural.
Innocent.
Wow. Yeah, so innocent. Yeah. And so I would talk about him, and people would, you know, there were people that would mock. And I remember one situation. I remember on a Monday, the manager, this was at Reading. I'd left Newcastle, went to Reading. I had a couple of years at Reading. And the manager at the time called me, and he pulled me in his office, and he said, look, and he was calling me Holy Joe, by the way, the manager. In training, you know, just having a crack.
Would he say that in front of everybody?
Yeah,
as
word,
well?
He would, he would. And and then he pulled me in one day and he said, look, you're not putting your foot in. What's the matter with you? You know, liven yourself up. And he was talking to me as if it was almost, my faith was affecting my performance. And that because I was a Christian, I wasn't tough enough in games, which I knew was total rubbish. And it did affect me a little bit, because as a football player, you're a part of a team. You don't want to be seen as the weak link, you know? It affected me, to be honest with you, for a while. And then obviously I was transferred from Reading to a Dutch football club. I spent 8 years in Holland, and there was absolutely no churches in Holland. You know, just nowhere to fellowship.
Really? I didn't know
that.
Yeah,
So
devoid of any sort of spiritual input or influence around you to actually even talk to somebody. So what was the difference then, you know, when you were in Brazil? Because I know there's a lot of people there who believe in God, and they're quite open about it.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it was an amazing experience, Howard, because in Brazil, I was able to express how I felt openly, more openly, and rather it being seen as a weakness, I felt empowered as a Christian, and I felt the strength of having God's favour on my life, whereas I'd been mocked in England, but I was being empowered in Brazil. Mm. People were, you know, they were really keen to hear my thoughts, and it was at that stage really that I really delved into the life of Jesus Christ.
And I suppose really, because I lived in North America, you know, for 10 years, and people were so different to what I'd been used to, where you just didn't talk about God in England at that time in the 80s.
Right.
And especially in the music business, a little bit like football, you just don't mention him. But then when you actually were in Brazil, you probably saw there was a lot more sort of talk about your faith amongst the teammates as well. Because we know, Kaká, for example, people like that.
Yeah.
Is Neymar a Christian as well?
Well, Neymar confesses, Jesus Christ after games. So many players. I mean,
David Luiz as well.
David Luiz. I think there was, 11 born again Christians in the World Cup final winning team.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, how
right from the, and even the coaching staff. And I had the privilege of being in some of the changing rooms before games, where the lads would pray together, and it's so powerful.
Wow. Yeah.
You know, when you're
I've
going
seen
on
David Luiz actually pray when he was with Chelsea for somebody else before the game.
Absolutely.
And not be afraid to do that.
Well, the boys would bring in a Louis Vuitton, toilet bag. Some of the boys, the non-believers, whereas the players, the Christians, would bring in a Bible under their arm. You know, and that's how David Luiz has actually changed the mentality at Chelsea when he was there, because he'd come in at match day with the Bible.
Yeah. Do you think that went down well with some of the hierarchy in the football?
Yeah, well, listen, I mean, we've got to be bold, haven't we, as Christians? Mm. And, you know, I love it when people of you know, prominence, like David Luiz, have the courage to expose people
well,
and take the lead.
Yeah.
But I mean, being a Brazilian, it doesn't surprise me, because they, tongue in cheek, they say in Brazil that God is a Brazilian, you know, because they believe his favour. I mean, they say that with, you know, with obviously
hand of God.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, they call it the hand of God, don't they?
I did it the other week because it was coming over, and it was too far ahead, and I was just by the goal, and I just put it in with my hand. You know, they
did a Maradona.
They went, oh, there you go, hand of God. But once they get used to you that you are a person of faith, it's a bit difficult at the beginning with the Brits, but then after a few years they can see where you're coming from, and they're really quite nice now to me. But they were a bit difficult at the beginning. So, but the greeting that they had for one another in Brazil was a little bit spiritual, wasn't it?
Yeah,
what was it? How did it go?
Well, it was when you actually part.
Mm-hmm.
So the Brazilian men would part, and they would say in Portuguese, "Fica com Deus," which means stay with God.
Say it again.
Fica com Deus.
Okay, right.
Stay with God.
Oh,
beautiful.
How nice. Yeah.
I mean, we sort of fell out the habit of saying God bless.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I remember when I was a small boy, I'd hear my uncle or my granddad and my dad say God bless at the end of a telephone conversation. We sort of lost that a little bit, haven't we?
Mm.
But in Brazil, all the players would say Fica com Deus, Fica com Deus. It was beautiful to hear. And it was really in Brazil, you know, although I'd had a relationship with God through my football career, I'd made a lot of mistakes too. You know, and
who hasn't?
Yeah, I mean, I made some poor choices, and I didn't really understand, you know, the consequences, the worldly consequences, and I used to feel that God was angry with me as well, because that was just a lack of understanding I had. But that was all changed when I lived in Brazil, and I realised that, you know, the love and the grace and the forgiveness that God has for us is just overwhelming.
Mm.
And when you get a glimpse of the love that he has, which I had in Brazil, it knocked me over.
Mm-hmm.
I remember explaining to somebody that for a period of time in Brazil, Howard, I was, I'd wake up in the morning like a child at Christmas. Do you remember that feeling you used to get?
The excitement.
Before, Christmas Eve.
Yeah.
You couldn't wake up quick enough.
I've lost it a bit.
Yeah, you're still there a little bit, you know.
Yeah.
But it was, I had that feeling for weeks after I gave my life. It was almost like I was overwhelmed by what he might do for me in that moment. You know, it was an incredible feeling, and I'll never forget. And I try and hold on to that now when I'm having little dips.
I was just going to ask you, what has been some of the challenges that you've had as a Christian? And, you know, coming from the background you have of being, you know, top of your profession, a professional footballer, heart's desire filled and all of that, and yet you're human, and we all have these different things to overcome, the challenges. So what was been some of your greatest ones?
Well, I think players fall into a lot of traps, you know. Gambling is a big problem in football today, even more so because the players earn a lot more money. But gambling was something that I was affected by. Women, you're young, you're a footballer, you know, not being faithful in a relationship. Coming from a tough background, it's about survival, you know, and you know, listen, you learn some stuff morally, but having to deal with all of those things, and then as you get older, looking back and feeling the guilt and the shame for all of that stuff, was amazing when I understood
the grace of God.
The grace of God and the sacrifice that was made on the cross that allows me to leave that behind, you know, and it's just an amazing gift that he's given us.
So in those moments where you've perhaps been really low and devastated, you realise what you've done, what was the road back? Well, you know, is there a sort of a testimony? Was there a scripture? Was there a word said to you or something that just sort of went, you know, that was a eureka moment?
Well, my eureka scripture is Romans 6:23. You know, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God you know,
everlasting
life through Jesus Christ, was something that completely changed my life, because I realized there is a consequence to sin, you know, but we can be forgiven through Christ. And that was life changing for me, because at one stage I felt that, you know, how was I ever going to pay that off? How could I get rid of it? Would I have to do 30 years of charity work, you know? Because that
it's
was a real issue
Bible,
I had.
Is it?
It's not biblical, is it?
Yeah, no.
You know,
we're saved by grace.
We're saved by grace, yeah.
Some of the other things, you know, tell us a little bit about the fact that you were working as an agent, a football agent.
Yeah.
So you were able to discover new talent. I know there's one in particular. I'll let you tell the story, though. Go on.
Yeah, I mean, that was... I had its challenges as well, though, Howard, because working as an agent in England, players look to agents of... They look like, you know, they're going to get some sort of power from the agent, someone who's going to be a strong negotiator, someone who's prepared to, you know, tip tables up to get contracts done. And when some of the players realised I had a face, they left because they didn't feel I was capable of doing a proper job.
A big deal. Because you'd be too soft.
Exactly. Yeah. Which again, the Brazil experience turned that on its head. Because obviously, as a Christian, we are empowered to go and do anything that we, you know, we desire in for His glory. So, but it was hard because the mentality here is different. It's different, and it's still changing. And a lot of young players still don't identify that empowerment. They see it more as a weakness. So I lost players because of my faith. So I had to be wise how I discussed it with them, but. When you're a Christian and you love Jesus, you want to talk about it.
Of
you want
course,
to tell everybody,
yeah.
And you don't want to keep it to yourself, you know?
Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, so you can't stop yourself
no,
sometimes
exactly,
sharing
and,
that.
Exactly, and I'm so full of the love of Christ that it was something that I found so difficult to hold back. But, you know, if I lost them, I lost them. There were occasions where players did hear and they would want to talk and ask questions. So, you know, I'm sure I've planted lots of seeds, never always saw the fruit, but I've planted seeds along the way, and hopefully some of the boys will remember that later on in life. And, you know, but Shay Adams was a good example. I think that was maybe the one.
That, yeah,
well, Shay was someone that picked up at a non-league football club at Ilkeston. He was on about £30 a week at Ilkeston playing non-league, a team in Derbyshire. And I watched him play three or four games. I thought he had everything as a young player. And managed to get him into professional football. He signed for Sheffield United and got into their first team. And like a lot of experience I've had, as soon as they start getting some fame and, you know, the attention of the media, that's when the sharks
come out.
Swim, you know, and... Unfortunately, like a lot of them,
talking other agents now.
Yeah, other agents would come in. It's a very
cutthroat
business, Howard. It's like the Wild West now, and I lost him. You know, he was talked into going with somebody else, and within maybe 3 or 4 months of them taking Shay, he went for I think £16 million to Southampton, which you know was an amazing move.
Would have
for
been
him.
A big ticket.
Yeah, it would have been a massive ticket, especially when
you know. Lee, I've got to say, just to encourage you, because, you know, Jesus said, you know, he who, you know, sort of talks about him in front of others will actually be talked about between Jesus and the Father, you know. So, you know, that way your reward might not be now, it'll be in the future. But certainly, you know, the football game is probably just like many other sort of media, like take, for example, the music industry or the film industry, agents come in and there's a lot of skullduggery goes on
absolutely.
Behind the scenes.
Absolutely, you know that. Yeah.
But what are you doing now?
Yeah, so there's a few interesting projects on the horizon. I'm still walking in faith. That's one of the most important things in my life, always will be. Well, it's the most important thing in my life, but obviously we live in the world and we have to survive. You know, and there's a few projects I'm involved with. One interesting one was something that happened recently. I call him a young man. He got into the final of The Voice, in Spain.
Really?
And I've sort of been managing his career for a little while now. He's a tremendous singer. And
well, that's quite an achievement. And is this a new aspect to what you're doing? Because as an agent,
well, I've managed you know players for 20 odd years, and that sort of
it's very similar
because it's man management. Yeah. It's man management. They've all got a little bit of an ego, you know. And this guy in particular, I won't mention his name because they haven't put it out on telly yet.
So we're
probably better off keeping it quiet. But he's actually got through to the final.
Amazing.
And he managed to turn one of the judges. Very recently.
So that was really exciting. The chair to say, was there a big gap between?
It was getting a bit hairy,
and it was going. Is anybody going to turn?
I think it was about
him.
Minute and a half. We're in, and we're thinking, don't look so good. And then the big star of the show, the big judge of the show, who's probably best well known.
Not to mention names.
He turned. Yeah. So we all went crazy for him, and so that's really nice because that gives me it's a different area for me. And
it's another thing, a box you can tick and say succeeded to get an artist onto The Voice, onto The Voice, but into the finals.
And who knows where he's going to go from here? You know,
brilliant.
And he's a Christian as well. So we pray before performances and. So it's wonderful, you know. God's incredible. He's been an amazing father, and I've had my struggles, but I think what God does, He can turn your shame into success, and that's what He's done for me, you know.
Now you've got other things that you perhaps want to do as well, and we only met just a few weeks ago, but the common denominator, football, and you hadn't played for a while, have you? You know, so and then I got you into a game, didn't I?
You did, I know.
Well, two games actually. Yeah. We go somewhat. What went from one game to the other, didn't we?
I must like you, Howard, because I tell you what, you to talk me to playing football again, not because I love the game, but I know the damage it does. Mm. It can do, because I had eight operations on my knees towards the end of my career, so I've got no cartilage in my knees. Mm. So if I do too much on them, they will
hurt.
They'll swell, and they did. But it was still for that 20 minutes. I felt it again. Yeah. You know, I felt that little buzz.
Yeah. Oh, good.
And I must say, I must say, Howard. I mean, you know, Revelation TV was a channel that I used to watch a few years ago when I was actually going through a little bit of a dip, and I got so much inspiration from the program and the TV show.
You just never know who's so watching.
And there we are playing together. Why don't we look at
some of your football videos, Howard? They're so inspiring.
Good save, keeper.
This is Howard when he was 70 years old, practicing shooting on goal. It's really inspirational to see the dedication that Howard has, you know, the work he puts in. That's probably why he scores so many goals in the games when he plays, you know. In his age group, he's quite a phenomenal goal scorer. And you can see he's really working the goalkeeper here. Terrific finish with his right foot, punishing the goalkeeper, to be honest. And that's a tremendous finish. Got good feet for his age, he moves his body well. And look at this, he receives the ball, controls it with one touch, follows the ball, hits it with his left foot and scores. And that's his weak foot. And here he is scoring a goal with his head. He likes to get his head on it in the box. Headers that one into the ground, but still scores. A sign of a proper goal scorer. Again, showing good feet, good agility. Chips the goalkeeper, very impressive. Scores a lot of goals in the 6-yard box. Inspirational for young players, you know, sometimes just get a goalkeeper, get a few balls, get yourself out on the pitch and just practice. Really good to see. That's really good technique that, as you can see, knocked it in the top corner. So after an hour of practicing shooting on goal, Howard is now going to play a game with his mates. He's ready to go. There's just no stopping him. I don't know where he gets the energy from. Amen to that, Howard. So why don't you come and join us sometime?
Yeah, soon.
Well, this is Lee Payne here, former Newcastle United footballer, professional scout and agent now for the last 20 years.
It's time you can't touch the ball with the same part of your feet.
We're going to be looking at some footage today of a young striker, Howard Conder, 73 years old. Incredible. This was at the Chelsea training day at Walton. I'm just going to pick up some really good points here of his game, how he gets himself in the box, his goal scoring ability and his technique. That was Howard there in the blue bib, just finishing at the far post. And what about that for a strike? Almost broke the back of the net. The ball come out like Jeff Hurst in 1966. Brilliant. I played with Howard a couple of weeks ago in a game. Very impressed with his work rate, his passion for the sport, you know, and his enthusiasm. And he can finish. He finishes regularly and scores lots of goals. There you go. Great right foot shot there. The keeper makes a great save. Let's look a little bit more footage here. You can see there, great first touch, gets it out of his feet and buries it in the corner. That's a terrific finish. No chance for the goalkeeper.
And coming, Howard, you've got a turn.
Howard does like a nutmeg, and there you go. You can see that in slow motion. Does that regularly. He doesn't do that by fluke. He knows what he's doing. Here we go again. Good feet, good bit of skill. Turns his defender, gets a shot off at the near post, and the keeper makes an easy save in the end. But then he follows that straight up, and there you go.
Yes,
he's a fox in the box, he's Howard. It's a terrific finish. It's another game. We're going to see games in England and in Spain at different levels. But in every game, you see his ability to finish. And that was a quality finish. He's took a good first touch and a lovely little dink over the goalkeeper.
Move, walk, take a couple of steps forward. Love it.
And there you go, there's Howard at the far post.
That's right. Love it. Well, boom.
He only needed one touch there at the far post. You see on the replay, good feet, good clean feet. And sticks it away there. Very impressive. Get some more footage here, another good finish. And that's a hell of a finish, look at that. Top of the net, no mucking about, no chance for the goalkeeper there. Again, shows good composure. Another goal, nice and relaxed in front of goal. And there's Howard at the far post now with one touch goal. Does it on a regular basis, this Howard.
Man up.
Here, this is an England over 60s trial game. And what about that for a finish on his right foot? Very relaxed, sticks it in the top bin. Very impressive. Very relaxed, very confident in front of goal. So, as you've seen with the clips, there's some real dexterity there from Howard. 73 years old, good movement, good energy levels, great feet. He knows how to score a goal. All in all, very impressive.
Didn't he do well, eh?
Amazing, you know. So I hold this, you know, this show and this television very close to my heart.
Oh, that's really good. That's good for us to know because, you know, sometimes you think, what we're doing, is it a waste of time? Could we be doing something else? But, you know, having testimonies of people that watch the channel and they're being fed, and especially at the time of greatest need, and that's really good that we're there for you.
No, I was going through a very difficult period, and Revelation TV, you know, I was sitting on my own in my, probably in Yorkshire somewhere at the time, and it would be something that I do on a daily basis. I'd tune in and I used to get inspiration. Just listen to God's word and the conversations you were having with some of your guests. So it really does make an impact. And and I know there's a lot of young men struggling. I've lost a couple of really close friends to suicide, you know, and I felt that they probably went down that route because they felt that there was nothing else out there for them. Mm. But there is, you know, there is. There's a loving God out there, you know.
Do you know, that's one thing that I can relate to, and I try to have an open door to help people to come through it, because I struggle as well with those things. So,
absolutely,
you know, I can empathize with them, but I so want to be able to reach out more to people who are depressed and who are thinking that this life has got nothing to offer. I mean, in general terms, that this life hasn't got a lot to offer, but what God has in store for us, especially when Jesus comes back and we've got the new heaven, new earth. But we've got to get through to then, and we've got to help each other.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so if Revelation TV could be something that you will benefit you like it has to Lee, then please do stick with us and give us a try, because we do have a heart to reach others and to continue to be able to help you to, you know, make it through this life. That's all we need to do. We're hanging on together. But, you know, mental health is something which is now quite openly spoken about.
Absolutely.
It isn't like a stigma like it used to be. Yeah. And especially if you're in a career, wherever you are, if you're at the top of your career, it's harder to even talk about it. But we see today among sports people, personalities, even royalty talk about these things. Yeah. So it is a good time to sort of stick together and work our way through it.
Thank God for that.
In life, as in football, we all go through highs and lows. We can all sometimes feel anxious or stressed. At moments, even the little things can seem a struggle. But we can all start to change things. Every Mind Matters and Heads Up will show you the simple steps you can take to look after your mental health. Helping to boost your mood, improve your sleep, and feel ready for life's ups and downs.
Search Every Mind Matters to get your mind plan.
It only takes a minute to get started.
The PFA do a great job now. They've opened up avenues for players to go and get help. But we know the ultimate medicine is coming to faith.
Yeah.
Because that's a strength that it's a supernatural strength that you can, you know, that you can draw from, that we have access to, and not enough of us reach out and make it a part of our life that we should be making a part.
Yeah. Well, the Bible is like a manual, or like the book that you get with your car or a new machine or something like that, the instruction manual for life.
Absolutely.
That's what I find, and it helps you to deal with different things in different situations. And what you need is the wisdom that is talked about in Proverbs and Ecclesiastes.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the important thing is it's being able to draw that wisdom up and out of the Bible at the times you need it. And that's why you need to know the Bible. And it's no good just having it as a book on your shelf or by your bedside table. You've got to read it.
Yeah.
And that's where it made a big difference to me.
I'm a proper working class lad, Howard. You know what I mean? I was brought up on a tough council estate, didn't go to church. But I find so much, you know, relevance in the Bible. I identify with Peter and Paul and, you know, some of the, even, you know, Elijah, one of the great prophets, struggled with life, didn't he? And he cried out to God because he wanted his life to end. The Bible's full of amazing men of faith who struggled. And
You get the good, the bad, and the ugly there.
It's absolutely.
It doesn't gloss over everybody and make them
absolutely.
Out to be a saint. This is what I think makes the Bible real in that
absolutely.
Sense.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah, you can draw strength from these characters. And these are real. I mean, look at David. You know, he took on Goliath. He was a small boy, you know, and became a king. And to
but
draw
he also
strength.
Made mistakes as
yeah,
well,
and,
you see?
And that, but that, I think real men, we need to identify and you know, take time to read and understand that these people were real and they had failures.
And yet God still said to him, there's a man after my own heart. After
exactly.
he had somebody put to death,
absolutely.
You know, somebody's
committed adultery.
Husband, yeah. And yeah. Committed adultery.
Yeah.
And yet God said, this is a man after my own heart. So God sees into our heart, into our
absolutely.
The deeper
yeah.
side of us, and sees the positive and will bring us through. And he can do that for all of us, you know.
Exactly. Well, I belong to a really lovely church as well now. It's called Encounter. David Hodgson and Naomi, his wife. And I do a radio show now on a Monday.
Oh, right. On
a sports
TRE.
Show on TRE with
yeah.
David. We talk about the Premier League football. I mean, I did a little bit of radio and TV work as a player and as an agent. And it was an area that I really love. You know, I love talking on the radio about football.
Mm.
You know, I could
Get
talk all day. Yeah, I could talk all day about football. So that's been really good.
And you can talk
good.
About football and God, can't you?
Absolutely.
In the same
yeah.
breath, you know?
Oh,
it's not like 100%. It's not like your God is football.
No.
Right.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. And they're probably my two favourite topics, you know? So, yeah. for sure.
Okay. Well, look, I'd like to invite you back sometime, because this is just the beginning, because there are things that we'd love you to do in
yeah.
Revelation TV as well
amazing,
in the future,
Howard.
Because
yeah,
I think want to introduce some football
yeah,
as well, because, you know,
That'd
why
be
not
brilliant.
Christians in football, you know?
I mean, there's so many out there, Howard.
Yeah.
There's so many out there.
But it also gives us a door into other people who are not Christian,
yeah,
and they could see our light shine, hopefully,
absolutely,
through our faith,
yeah,
when we mix with them and when we play with them. So I'm hoping that we could do something down here in Spain, and you get involved with that. Are you up for that,
Howard? That'd be amazing. It'd
right.
be amazing. And I know there's a lot of players out there that are struggling. And if there was an avenue and a channel for them to, in the same way I did,
mm.
you know, I got so much encouragement from Revelation TV, so I know what it can do,
yeah.
you know, and be wonderful to do something like that
Brilliant.
In the future.
And to work with young children as well, to be able to train them as well,
yeah.
and guide them into a career that would be along and akin with what you've done
Absolutely.
As well.
Absolutely, it'd be a joy.
Well, is there anything else you want to share? Otherwise, I think, you know, this has been a really good interview and getting to know you, Mr. Lee Payne.
No, no. You know? Like I say, I'd just like to say that my experience and God's brought me through so much, so many trials and tribulations, and I feel that now, really, really, really quickly, I remember going to Malta for a few days. I wanted to follow Paul's footsteps because we know he was shipwrecked just off the island of Malta. And I wandered into a church one evening, and I actually sat near the front in the end because the usher took me to the front. I wanted to sit at the back. It was just a random church. It was an evangelical church. And I just wanted a night of worship. And I was there as a tourist. And the pastor stood up and said, I've got a word for somebody tonight. He said, I don't know where it's come from, but I'm being obedient, because it's going to sound really strange. But he said, there's someone here tonight that needs to stop chasing footballs and start chasing souls.
My goodness.
And this went down my, you know, this thing went down my spine. I think, oh no, he's talking to me. He's got to be talking to me. And you know, he walked where I was sitting, he walked past and he said, that was for you.
Mm.
And I was a tourist. I hadn't even, nobody knew who I was. Incredible word from God. So I know that he's going to use some of the trials and tribulations I've had, my career as a footballer, and now the faith that I have. I'm sure there's a you know, a calling on my life to do something positive.
Yeah.
For his glory.
Amen to that. Well, if we can help you in any way at Revelation TV to accomplish that, yeah, that would be a great job
done. That'd be wonderful, Howard.
Bless you, Lee.
Yeah, bless you.
All right, I just want to say to you all at home, thank you for watching this particular interview. Do pray for Lee, because there's lots more that God can do in his life as well as yours.
Hi, my name's Lee Payne, ex-professional footballer, 20 years as a football agent. This is a real privilege to speak to you, because I went through a tough period a few years ago in the UK, and started tuning into Revelation TV, And through my depression and even at times suicidal thoughts, Revelation TV made such a difference to my life. And it's almost a godsend that I'm able to thank the people of Revelation TV that got me through that period. I sat there on my own in my front room at times, so low, in such a deep, dark place. And to have an outlet like Revelation TV that would share God's word and fill me with encouragement was a massive help to me to get through that period. So to get this opportunity to thank everybody involved with Revelation TV is an honor. And you know, I just want to tell people that if you're going through tough times, whether you're a Christian or a non-Christian, this is a great place to come and just share other people's thoughts and beliefs. And I'm sure that it'll have an impact, I hope, in the same way that it impacted my life.